they found through epigenetics that within in the Holocaust, the generation afterwards still were affected and impacted by the trauma. And that was just less than a decade that that period was in existence, right? That horror happened. We have 400 years of that.
Mm-hmm.
What's the impact of 400 years of bondage and all that went with it? What impact is that, both good and bad, on our genes?
So the good, well, here's the thing. So let's unpack how true this is first. So let's give the facts, right?
Okay.
All right. So epigenetics is this idea that your actual DNA doesn't change, right? But the chemicals that say genes should express during a certain time and not express during another time, that's epigenetics. So your actual DNA does not change. But external influences, mostly the environment, can impact if your genes are on or off. So a nice way to think about this is, let's think about sleep, right? So you have different chemicals that come in and say, oh, Karen, it's time for you to go to bed. You're tired. Karen, you're hungry. And the genes express to reflect that, right? So this hypothesis about trauma is saying that you are expressing different genes because you're experiencing trauma. And there have been studies that show this. And a lot of them have been on military, right? PTSD. The others have been on Holocaust, World War II, and famine, right? All of these, you know, trauma events, except for the biggest one in the entire existence of humans.
So they've never studied.
Which is slavery, right? So there are, like, I have not found any genetic study. Now, I've seen a lot of, you know, psychological studies on the effects of slavery, but not any genetic study. And I think there's a bunch of reasons as why. So the short answer to the question is that we don't know. Right. There's not enough science to know that. The longer answer is, why don't we know? Don't know. Why don't we know? Right. And it kind of ties back into, you know, these issues of, one, let's be honest, who's interested? Who are the people? I'm interested. Right. But how many people like, you know, you and me are the ones deciding who gets grants? How many people are like you and me are the ones deciding, you know, who are writing the papers? So we need more of us to write the papers, to be there to ask these questions, because one, the people who have this power are not interested in answering this question, right? And then two, there's a big gap in, like, how do we answer this question? How do we understand it? How do we figure it out?
In the book, The Half Has Never Been Told, Edward Baptist, the historian, writes about Patsy, who picks 500 pounds of cotton a day. She's featured in 12 Years a Slave, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he talks about the evolution within a generation, that Patsy was able to separate the hemispheres of her brain to be able to pick cotton with such dexterity that she could, because cotton is a skill. It's not about weight and strength. It's about being able to have dexterous fingers to be able to do that. She could zone out her creative side and pull the technical and bring them together, and she evolved within a generation. And I posited that if that were happening with this one person, then it must have been happening throughout. And what does that mean for future generations in terms of evolution? You know, so I was just, because evolution usually takes a long period of time, right?
I do. So here's the thing. I do believe that, though. Like, I do. I am very much so invested in this hypothesis that there is a biological and social component to explain, you know, the years, hundreds and thousands of, well, not thousands, but hundreds of years of slavery. And then, you know, the aftermath of slavery and Jim Crow and segregation. All of these things have impacted us. But I think personally, a lot of what's being passed down are things like survival skills, really, right? Because that's why we're still here, right? So I don't think, how has the trauma, you know, helped us survive is going to be the question that we need to ask. Why, if we're the most oppressed, do we have the lowest suicide rates? Why? I mean, we got to talk about that, right? But there's a social component to that. There's a psychological component to that, to explain, you know, well, what about our sense of community? What about the way in which we socialize with each other,
mm-hmm.
that, you know, kind
We're
of bring
able
us together?
To make a joke out of everything.
Listen, we will reinvent and make the hardest situations the most beautiful. We're really good at that.
I had a doula on yesterday.
Okay.
Mm. Okay. And she was talking about when she was born, her mother saw her grandmother and knew that she was going to be a girl. And it was such a spiritual conversation we were having. It was bugging me out because I was getting tingly feelings. And she was talking about the spirit connection between the mother and the baby, and but the ancestors and being involved. Is that gene or is that something else? Is that, do we have a connection to our ancestors that go back generations and generations? And what does that look like?
Yeah, I mean, most definitely. Let's think about, if we think about most African, a lot of the African derived religions from the places that we're from, right, are really lenient on this idea of ancestral spirituality, right? And we're not really taught about our African, like, I can ask a lot of my friends, name three African-derived religions, and we're all like, you know? But we can name others from across the world. But that's a whole nother issue, right? But anyway, a lot of them trace back to, you know, this connection to our ancestors. So a lot of our native religions from West African were really connected to the ancestors. Now, to answer your question, I most definitely think it's, you know, genetic. What I think is genetic, me personally, when I think about my ancestors, they live literally within me. They are in my DNA. And there's not a scientist who would tell me differently.